of serpent-like personalities. And then there's a certain, you know, how many of y'all just see, well, depending on where you live, you might see it. But it's not often in the city that you just see serpents crawling down the highway. Generally because there's not many places for them to hide. But it come around spring, you know, and you see some places that may have some high grass, some moisture, some rocks, you know. You might go around there and you might find your old garter snake. So we want to keep our gardens groomed so that our gardens don't become a place where serpent-like spirits and mindsets and attitudes and behaviors that they're comfortable being there. Serpents like to strike from a hiding place or when they feel threatened and cornered. Feel threatened, you know, back into a corner. I like watching those shows where people catch snakes. My wife don't like it, but I like watching those shows. And the reason why I like watching because I'm fascinated by the many species. And there's this one, it's called a green mamba and a black mamba. And these snakes are very aggressive. They're very aggressive. In fact, they'll jump out of a tree on you. They're highly, highly potent as it pertains to their body. Brothers and sisters in the body of Christ, some of us have been bitten by serpents who have got comfortable living around us, and we have not recovered from the snake bite. I saw another video the other day where they took a viper and they grabbed a hold of its head. You know how they take those snakes and they put its mouth up over that little cup and those big fangs come out, goes inside the cup, and then it releases the venom into the cup. If I'm freaking out, I'm sorry. But I'm trying to paint this picture with words so that you understand. Well, they took a dropper, like an eyedropper, and they took one drop of that snake's venom and put it in about a half a cup of blood. And when they put that one drop of that snake's venom in a half a cup of blood, that blood gained consistency. So when they poured it out of the glass, it was like a ball. And I think that that's what the poison of the enemy does to people of God who have great potential in the kingdom to be more than what we've settled to becoming. You know, the Apostle Paul in the book of Acts, he was bitten by a viper. But the faith that Paul had, the scripture says that people looked upon him. But as he was bitten by the viper who come out of the fire at him. Ain't that something? It was sitting around fire waiting for that apostolic grace to get close enough just so it could latch on to him. But the Bible said the Apostle Paul took it and he shook it right off, right into that fire. Y'all know the scriptures?
Yeah.
He shook it right off into that fire and said that the people watched him to see if he would perish.
That's right.
Paul didn't let anything bother him. I'm praying that God will anoint us today to shake off some of the things.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Nobody's saying you didn't get bit. It's obvious you got bit. People have witnessed you got bit. Sometimes the faith of your enemy expecting you to fall and expecting us to fall short and expecting us to succumb to the pressure, sometimes that in itself is worth to the bite. But I need to tell you this morning, you're going to make it. I need to tell you, you're going to overcome this. You're going to superabound. You're going to come out victorious.
Yes.
Amen. What the enemy made for evil, God has made it for our good. So y'all let me teach this because you need this information and you're going to need it in the element of spiritual warfare. Before last Sunday, we spoke of the book of Daniel. We talked about how Daniel was a primary leader in the marketplace. And how, in fact, we left off at Daniel, the 9th chapter. And we can't go through a review today because I've got a lot to share with you. And I want to save some of this voice for tonight because they're going to push me hard tonight at this church.
off of Hall Street. But that's not going to take away from what y'all received this morning. Amen. We left off with Daniel, and Daniel has become prime minister over Babylon. We understand the word Babylon resembles what? Chaos. It represents confusion. But Babylon also represents a form of government that has the majority of its citizens living and prospering within that land, but then with also in that same Babylonian structure, there's not only citizens, but there are subjects. And how many of you know that there's a difference between a citizen and a subject? A citizen of a country has full rights and liberty that comes along with that country, but a subject is locked into a subculture which does not present the exact same rights. In fact, the rights that for the citizen that come automatic, in some cases, the citizens will have the subjects believe that they have to earn their right to be able to dwell in their midst. And in many cases, a high level of prejudice, not necessarily racial, but prejudice in the sense of what rights we're enabled to and what we're given access to as far as our social class. Amen? Okay. And so with that being said, Daniel understood by the books when he read through Jeremiah that there was a level of suffering that had come across the nation of Israel that he wanted to make sure he brought to an end. So he extended himself and he gave himself to a lifestyle of not just healthy eating. Somebody say healthy, clean eating. Y'all don't like me today. Of healthy, clean eating. Because in order for us to effectively maximize our role in the kingdom of God, brothers and sisters, we have to be healthy. I cannot emphasize this enough. And maybe it's because the older I get, the more I'm realizing that I have to take extra care to make certain things fit and work like they used to. Anybody agree? That after you hit that, you know, how many of y'all was like me, you know, in my early 20s, I could eat as many burgers and fries and milkshakes and cakes and everything else, and I wanted to, and I was a hoss in the gym, you know, just in the gym all the time, lifting weights and, you know, power lifting and, you know, just, oh, as long as I lift weights and as long as I'm there, I'm going to be fine. And then 40 hit. And then after 40 hit, 43, 42, and it started growing, I started realizing I'm still just as strong as I used to be, but things ain't looking the same. And the one thing my brother and I hated to do is I had to start making sure that I did some cardio. So I started doing my little cardio, you know, thinking that was going to change. And I kind of realized that my wife had been telling me since we met, baby, it's your diet. So I realized it. Because one of the things I realized is I had friends who could run a marathon, who were physically exterior. On the exterior, they looked like the picture of health, but they were dropping like five flies, falling out, having massive heart attacks and strokes because they were not taking care of their temple. It bothers me to see worship leaders and pastors and people of God who claim that the body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, but we refuse to take care of that very temple that we say God lives in. Our life, how we live, what we eat, is a reflection of our worship to God. Okay, so I'm going to get off the soapbox now. Amen? But I want you to take care of yourself. God has too much in store for you and too much of a plan for your life for you to check out early because of bad health. I'm going to say this. Even some things genetically that we say are passed down hereditarily, some of that stuff can be reversed through a right diet. Amen? Stay away from these demonized processed foods. You know, the easy eating. I know I'm getting on this morning, but I love you. You know, the easy eating. Hey, how many of us, I'm too busy to eat right? That was my game. Well, I'm busy. I got to get something fast, fixed in a hurry. You know, but you know, it takes a few minutes to prepare that little bag before we go to work. And have it with us. You know, lean cuts of meat, not overdoing it on the pork. So many of our cultures, you know, we just celebrate high blood pressure and heart disease and gout. You know, like that's just part of our family. Diabetes, you throw that in there too. Oh, that's just who we are. You know, I'm amazed. Well, this is not a list, so we'll move. Amen. Y'all get the picture, right? Okay, so take care of yourself. Take care of yourself.
But I'm gonna mention little things each and every week about this, because a healthy church cannot just be healthy spiritually, but we ought to be healthy physically.
Amen.
Okay? All right. So there's Daniel. And Daniel's healthy. Daniel's healthy. He has a great diet. But even in the midst of having that diet, he understands that he has to extend himself a little bit further, because his clean eating habits and physical health are not enough to move this demonic oppression that is upon his nation. And so now he goes from what we call the Daniel fast, which is really the Daniel diet, and Daniel really begins to fast. And you find that fast. Go to Daniel, I believe it's the 10th chapter, if you will. We're going to come back to Matthew in just a moment. Let me show you all this, and we'll pull from there and go straight to the book of Matthew. I want you to go to Daniel chapter 10. Amen. This is for those of y'all that think that when we fast that we're crazy and, you know, that we are hard on people. It's not that. Go to Daniel chapter 10. Look at verse number 3. Daniel 10 and 3. Daniel 10 and verse number 3. Let's go there and look at that. I want y'all to see that and how Daniel begins to set the pace for how he's going to begin to intercede on behalf of the nation. Daniel 10, verse number 3. Can y'all go there for me? You got that, Brother Ricky?
Yes.
Thank you, sir. Look what it says, Daniel 10. We'll start with verse 2. It says, in those days, I, Daniel, was mourning 3 full weeks. So there's your 21 days. You see that? There's your 21 days. Now, what we read about Daniel, the first chapter, what we call the Daniel fast in the church arena, when he just ate fruits and vegetables and things like that. That's the Daniel diet. According to scripture, this is what the Daniel fast was actually. He said, I ate no pleasant bread, neither came flesh nor wine in my mouth, neither did I anoint myself at all till the 3 whole weeks were fulfilled. Now that's something there, Sister Faye, because I'm going to tell you what that really means. When Daniel says that, first and foremost, the purpose of his fasting, and he relates his fasting to actually mourning. So he's weeping for his people. He's weeping for Israel. He's weeping for a nation. Intercession, true intercession, is love, agape love, the love of God in its most sincere form. And it is when one will sacrifice their flesh to purify that flesh so that they can gain access to a deeper level in the realm of the Spirit. Amen? People who are carnal minded are going to struggle with doing this. And the reason they're going to struggle with doing this is because most folks who are carnal minded, and I say this with all respect, their God is their belly. Their God is their belly. It's whatever satisfies me. It's things that I say I can't go without. Amen. I want you to take your mind back to the original diet God gave Adam. I want you to think about that. Okay. But he said, I ate no pleasant bread. Doesn't mean that he didn't eat. Please don't confuse that. He said, I ate no pleasant bread. In other words, let's put it in our terms, he put up all of his comfort food. Everything that he just felt like I got to have. You know those cravings that we get? He put all that up. And then he said, neither came any flesh. So that means he didn't eat any meat. So even on his Daniel diet, there was things that he found that were comforting to him when he ate it. And so he set aside everything that brought his flesh satisfaction, and he began to go into a place of mourning for the nation. Neither flesh nor wine in my mouth. Now, I don't recommend this, but Daniel was chosen to do it. When he says, I didn't anoint myself, that ain't talking about like the church anoints people. You go back and study the Hebrew, Daniel didn't take a bath. So when they say he was mourning, he was really mourning. I mean, he went into a place to where if people wanted to be around him, after that 3 weeks, he had no problem being in isolation praying. Okay? Y'all thought I was being funny a couple weeks ago when I put that message out on the remind that as you're fasting, please put that mint in your mouth to ward against that spirit of halitosis. Y'all thought I was playing. Because when your body starts cleaning itself out, one of the first places that get foul is that tongue. I don't know if that's a type of shadow of a nasty mouth or what it is. But I do know that we have to make sure that when those toxins begin to come out, it's released through our mouth. And so we want to make sure that while we're consecrating and fasting,
that we're not bringing an offense to those we're talking to. We're going to put that thing in that mouth before we talk. Spray that thing. Amen? Is that okay? Y'all laughing at me. So Daniel, he said he didn't fast. He didn't anoint himself for an entire 3 weeks. As you study Daniel, the 10th chapter, you're going to find that Daniel got an exciting move of God because the angel Gabriel begins to visit him. And he comes in and he gives Daniel an interpretation of what he read in the book of Jeremiah, the 26th chapter and the 29th chapter. And then he says something to Daniel that's very, very profound. He says, I heard you from the day you prayed. From the very day that you begin to pray, Daniel, I heard your prayer. But the problem was not that I heard. So when we're consecrating ourselves and interceding on behalf of our family and loved ones, we don't know that you need to go through this season of frustration because it's not happening fast enough. We have to understand that one, that the primary reason for consecration is we need to engage with the Spirit. Now, don't y'all get deep on me, because for those of y'all that still read your horoscopes and got one to know what the daily scope is, you know, some people are more comfortable with doing that than they are with talking about this. And let me share something with you. We are living in a world that has been occupied by real devils. By real devils. And at some point in our spiritual walk, we have to understand and engage with that. Because if we deal with spiritual issues from a cardinal standpoint, we're going to lose every single time. The scripture said that the weapons, though we walk after the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare, they are not carnal. In other words, I'm not going to go up against a spiritual juggernaut, a spiritual principality that is over a region, a spiritual principality that has been crippling my family. For those of us who keep seeing these reoccurring infirmities popping up in our family members and it's unexplainable, that's a stronghold in operation. And so what's got to happen is that family now has got to come together, and we've got to what? We've got to be intentional. The gift of intentionality is a precious gift from God. And the spirit of religion is one of the primary spirits that wants to bind up our intentionality. Why? Because the spirit of religion says, just wait on God, he'll fix it. The spirit of religion says, pray and sit still. The spirit of religion says, pray and do absolutely nothing. The spirit of religion says, pray and worry. Every time you got to try to go to another level in your life, the spirit of religion says, hey, just make sure you attend church on Sunday. Just make sure that you pay your tithes and offerings. Well, thank God for that. But those two things alone are not going to move these spiritual giants and strongholds that are coming in and captivating our families. Are y'all with me this morning?
Amen.
And so there's got to be some action in the army of the Lord. Amen? There has to be some strategic planning. There has to be some intentional planning. There has to be somebody in the family that's going to stand up and take the lead. Because no troop can take over a region or a nation without a strong leader. Amen, somebody. Amen. Praise God, somebody.
Amen.
So there has to be some outlines. There has to be some blueprints. There has to be some strategies. So if cancer keeps reoccurring in our families, we got to go back and research, why does this cancer keep showing up in our generation? Why does it keep showing up? Why is it that asthmatics show up and skips one or two generations and this person didn't get it, but we can count on every other person? What's going on? Is it in the diet? Is it in how we entertain ourselves? Is it a stressful environment? Amen. What is the immune system so low so that when we go to face those germs that are in the air that we can't fight back because God created us to be able to restore and recover? Cut your finger, amen, and see what happens. If you got a good, healthy blood system and a good, healthy immune system, that cut's going to do what? It's going to start coming right. But God created us to heal on our own. Do you hear what I'm saying? He created that human body to be able to heal on its own. But when that serpent bites us and we mentally begin to disseminate and begin to fall into a place of Lodibar, what happens in our natural mind affects our body. Don't you know that the Bible says that so is a man thinking in his heart, so is he? And I would hate to believe, my dear brothers and my dear sisters, that some of the things that continue to creep up in our bloodline and our body is simply because we have not gotten over it spiritually, and now it's having an effect on our families naturally. Listen close. And so there has to be a process put in place where someone in the family says, you know what? We're going to confront this spirit of infirmity. infirmity that just so happens to be manifesting in the form of cancer. Amen. And what are we going to do? Well, the first thing we're going to do is we understand that those cells are triggered by what? Heavy levels of oppression, heavy levels of unforgiveness, heavy levels of anxiety, holding on to things and not being able to loosen. It also is coupled and partnered with what? A bad diet. Can I help somebody here this morning? A bad diet. There's certain things that are laced with certain types of preservatives that was never meant to go into the human body. In fact, our body will not digest certain chemicals that we put into it that has a shelf life. Go on down there to McDonald's and get you a burger. Put it on the shelf for about a year and a half. Unwrap it and see if that burger still does not have its same consistency. Why don't McDonald's, I done said it now. McDonald's and Wendy's, I might as well get it all out. I don't know about Chick-fil-A, we ain't done that test just yet. But why don't those fries mold and age? Well, why don't they? Why do they stay and keep their consistency? There's been tests that's been shown. Why? It's because of what that food is laced with. It's what is given to preserve its life. Everything that we put in our body is supposed to have a shelf life. Amen? I go get a tomato out of my garden, put it on that shelf, I'm not going to eat that bad boy. Why? Because it's turning colors. It's changing. Amen? Hallelujah, somebody. God put everything in this earth that was necessary to preserve itself. Amen? And so when we go and begin to take things, foreign objects, and put it in our natural body, it's paramount to the spirit of unforgiveness. Hebrews, the 12th chapter, lets us know. Follow peace with all men, without which no man shall see the Lord. Y'all know the scripture, don't you? Lest therefore a root, y'all hear this? A root of bitterness spring up amongst us and causing many to what? Stumble. Amen, somebody. We want to come against that spirit of cancer that comes from bad diets, that comes from unforgiveness, that comes from the enemy setting up shop within ourselves. And there's certain things that we're not able to pass through that large intestine. Amen, somebody. That we're not able to pass through that large intestine because repetitive cycles of bad eating blocks up the digestive tract. Amen? And it's the same in the spirit realm. There's things that get blocked up in our bloodline that are at the digestive tract because we have a bad spiritual diet. The things that we pour into our mind, that gossip and bad talk and inferiority, and the things that people have said to us over the years that attached itself to us, it begins to set up shop and take an abode down in our spiritual man. And in that spiritual man, somebody say, he's got to be set free. Yes, he does, brothers and my dear sisters. And maybe I can't get set free. In fact, I'm not designed to get set free by myself. That's why I need a brother. That's why I need a sister. That's why I need somebody who will stand up and say, we're not going to let, amen, strong man's his name. Hallelujah. What is his game? He's got to go. Shirley Caesar had a song. What was that strong man song she wrote years ago? She said, he's got to get up out of here. He's got to go. He can't live in this house anymore. And I don't know who I'm talking to this morning, but I sense in my spirit that there's been a strong man that has been over some of our families, and over the past years, we keep seeing these reoccurring issues of suicide, these reoccurring issues of sicknesses and infirmities, these reoccurring issues of broken relationships, these reoccurring issues of divorce and children being born out of wedlock unnecessarily. Do you hear what I'm telling you? It is a cycle, praise God. And somebody in the family has got to show the agape love of God and love on these ones that are in our midst, but at the same time, be willing to go into that prayer closet and be like Daniel and say, I'm not going to eat anything that brings pleasure to my flesh. Why? Because I'm dealing with a fleshly problem, and I need to get past the flesh and into the realm of the spirit. It's mighty through God. Why? To pull down that stronghold. What is a stronghold? The stronghold is a place in the mind where the enemy sets up shop and is chosen to operate. So the minute that I operate and feel a spirit of unforgiveness coming over, there's a strong man that enters into that gate, and there he sits. And every time you have an opportunity to trust, every time we have an opportunity to go into an open door that no man can shut, every time we have the opportunity to build new relationships, relationships. That strong man reminds us of that issue, that snake bite that we had years ago. And because we didn't shake it off, we took it to bed with us. That's why the Bible said, don't let the sun go down on your wrath. Hallelujah. That the man, hallelujah, somebody. He said, we got to forgive quickly and send our accuser bring us before the judge. Peter said, how many times must I forgive? Up to 77 times, 7 times. Jesus said, up to 70 times 70. Many shall offenses come, but woe unto him to whom they come. For it will be better for them to have a millstone tied around their neck and be cast into the sea than to stumble some of my little ones. And I need to encourage somebody in this building this morning who has been bitten by the serpent. You didn't see it, but you saw his trail after he bit you. Hallelujah. You didn't even see it coming. You trusted, you loved, you gave all that you had. You invested your time, your talent, and your revenue into that situation, and it got bit. But I come to tell you that there's a man named Jesus. Hallelujah, somebody. Who gave his life for me. We talked about it last week, how he was raised up from the dead and how he went down into the depths of hell and preached to the spirits that were held captive by Hades. And when Jesus went down and took those keys, he came back up and he declared out of his mouth that all power has been given unto me in heaven and in earth. And he looked at those disciples and said, behold, I give you that same power. It was the power to tread on the serpent that bit you. Hallelujah. And to take the bite of a scorpion. And he said these words, nothing shall my enemies harm you. Somebody ought to get excited just for about 30 seconds and say, you know what, I'm so glad that I took the bit. I took the bite. I took the hit. But what the devil has meant for evil, God has made it for my good. That thing that tried to get my blood to climb up and start flowing, I got a touch from the blood of Jesus. And when the blood of Jesus hit my body, it washed me. Survived the snake bites. Yes, Lord, it was my old familiar friend that sat at my table. Learned about my intelligence, learned about my plans, learned, got to know my family, got to know who I was. I told him the deepest, darkest secrets about my life. And it was that person I brought to the table. But why do you think David declared that thou preparest a table for you in the presence of your enemies? It's because God is preparing you to sit across the sea from your Judas and not lose your kingdom mindset, and still yet have communion, and still yet have the Lord's Supper, and still take and eat, because this is my body which was broken for you, and still take and drink ye, for this is the cup which is my blood, which is the New Testament. That's why David understands that there is a more excellent way for us to live. It's not by power, it's not by might, but it's by the Holy Ghost, brothers and sisters, that we're going to be able to penetrate the kingdom of darkness.
Yes, God. Yes, God. Yes, God.
Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord.
Y'all sit down.
Yes, Lord.
Y'all sit down.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Daniel. Brother Richard, Daniel understood this. He said, despite what I've experienced, I still yet have to exercise my right to love. Somebody say that. You need to hear that. I have a right to love.
I have a right to love.
You know, when love is stripped from you, your identity is stolen. That's worse than your credit cards being stolen. That's worse than your driver's license. That's worse than your car being stolen. It's when your joy has been taken. When your joy has been taken, that's when you're having an identity crisis. When you can't find peace in anything, that's when you're really having an identity crisis. It's when you can't see your way out of a crystal clear glass window, but you still can't see your way out because you can't see your last failure in life. Amen. Daniel enters into a supernatural dimension, and the angel Gabriel tells Daniel, I heard you. From the very moment that you prayed, Daniel, I heard your prayer. But he said these words, but the prince of Persia, held me up. And it means they held me up. In other words, there was a spiritual war going on between the messenger of the covenant, Gabriel. I call him the minister of intelligence. Every good military and every good nation needs a minister of intelligence and a minister of defense. This is the art of warfare. Intelligence is kingdom classified information. In other words, when you pray in tongues, when you pray in tongues, that is kingdom classified information. Amen, somebody. When you pray in the Holy Ghost, that's kingdom classified information. The scriptures tell us that when a person speaketh in an unknown tongue, he speaketh unto God. Amen, somebody. Hallelujah. He speaks unto God. In other words, when you begin to get filled with the Holy Spirit in that prayer, when the last time, brothers and sisters, that we really got into that place, if ever, to where the way we used to pray in the realm of the Spirit, has that thing begin to be dormant on the inside of you? Have you looked to your left and looked to your right and there's trouble on every side? Then you got to get that gift reenacted. And I'm not talking about according to the religious mode where we run around acting like we're lunatics and everybody in the whole house is praying in tongues and people that's in the church who don't yet have the gift don't understand it. No, they need prophecy. And that word prophecy is not talking about future telling and the foretelling of events. It's talking about a declaration of the word of God through the spirit of truth, because tongues edify self while prophecy edifies the unbeliever. How do y'all know that's good doctrine, church? I said that's good doctrine. I said tongues edifies who? The person who's speaking unto God. It don't help this brother if I'm standing up in here speaking in tongues. He knows not what I say except I have an interpreter. Hallelujah. If we can't just interpret any old part of what we want to, you have to have the gift of interpretation that rests down upon you. We're talking about order in the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. Not just being a gifted church. Hallelujah. But a gifted and spiritual and church that is a house that is set in order. Amen, somebody. Hallelujah. How many of you know that we cannot advance the kingdom of God in chaos? If we're chaotic in our minds and chaotic in our thinking, if we're not unified in spirit and in truth, if we don't believe that there's one Lord, one faith, one baptism, if we don't understand that we are the one worthy of vocation, of the vocation in which we were called, amen, that we might bring unity of the spirit. I need you to tap somebody if you're not ashamed and say, honey, I don't mean no disrespect, but this next move is really not about you. This next move is about advancing the kingdom of God. And we need people from every walk of life. We need people who are skilled in the art of warfare. We need people who are skilled in the art of intelligence. Why? Because the things that we see in the earth are just a pattern of the things that are in heaven. So if Jesus had a Michael who was the minister of defense, every local church needs a Michael. Every local church needs somebody who got the spirit of Michael. Those are the intercessors. It's not that group of people that sit on the front row and look real deep all day. No. It's the folk that observe what a discernful eye. And see, I see they need this. I see they need help over there. I see they need to work on this. But instead of me exposing to the enemy what I know, so he attacks, I'm going to go into my prayer closet. And when I get in my prayer closet, I'm going to pray in a language that speaks only to God. Hallelujah. So that the devil cannot understand.
Yes, God. Yes.
Do y'all hear what I'm telling you?
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Daniel received that kingdom intelligence from the archangel Michael. From Gabriel. And Gabriel says, I'm trying to get the message to you. So Yahweh deployed somebody who can handle the stronghold, the strong man. He sent Michael so I could come to you. See, y'all, we missing in church. You know why? Because many times we don't understand that everybody's role is equally important. Everybody's role is equally important. What was Daniel trying to get us to understand? Go back to Matthew now. Go back to Matthew, the 16th chapter. Is this lesson helping anyone?
Yeah.
Okay. Go back to Matthew. I want you to look back at Matthew, the 16th chapter. And let us look back down. Ooh, boy.
give you just a few more minutes and I'll let you go. We'll close this out. Go to Matthew, the 16th chapter, and let us look at verse 18 and 19. We'll move quickly with these scripture readings, okay? Matthew 16, 18 and 19. And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my ecclesia, my church. In the gates, parentheses, I'm saying this, meeting places, shall not of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give unto thee, or to you, the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Somebody say exousia. Or exousia is the way you pronounce it in Greek. Exousia. That word means delegated authority. Exousia. Delegated authority. In our legal terminology today, we will say power of attorney. What does it mean to have power of attorney? When you have power of attorney. So anybody ever been employed? Brother Richard, what can I ask? What does it mean to have power of attorney?
Someone else has the right to sign your name.
Absolutely. Somebody now has the right to sign your name. There's been an agreement made between the person who's deployed and the person who is back, and giving that person or individual or entity the authority to sign legal documents or to use that person's name. And the utilization of that person's name comes with the same weight as if that person said it himself or herself. And this is where we miss it, believers. Because when we say the name of Jesus, we don't utilize the name of Jesus as if he's given us the power of attorney. You know, that's why we don't see the miracles that we're supposed to see, because we say it religiously. And then we use his name so vicariously. In some cultures, they replace swear words with the name of Jesus. Jesus is not a good substitute for what we're trying to not say is bad word. That's a name that when that name is spoken, there's supposed to be something that has come in and occupied the business arena. See that? Business arena. Somebody say business.
Business.
The business sector. Go to Matthew 16. Y'all not mad because I'm not hollering out of here. Okay. Matthew 16. We can have services like that, but sometimes you need to get some good strong meat so that when you go back into your life this week, you understand how to deal with what you're facing. Mark the 16th chapter. So who in the family is going to stand up? Who in the family is going to make the difference? Who in the family is going to be the first to forgive? Who in the family is going to set the trend to uproot spiritually rooted diseases? Who's going to be the first in the family that's going to break the cycle of poverty? Who's going to be the first group in the family that's going to be a trendsetter as it pertains to family unity? Who's going to be the trendsetter as it pertains to the men in the family taking the lead in the home in worship first, then in provision, and family duties, and exercising those rights? You know, we got to have those things. Who's going to be the cycle breaker? Or are we just going to settle with, you know, men are insignificant now? Do you see how men are portrayed across the media today? How often do you really see a strong male figure across the media today? They're wiping them completely out. And that's been starting for years now. You know why it started for years now? Because back in the 80s, we lost that. 80s, 90s, we started losing that strong male figure in them. And then as it began to take, that trend began to set, as the male was displaced from the home, we began to birth a generation of fatherless children. Hear me, church? Fatherless children. Children that are so dependent on mama that they think they don't need that. And I'm going to tell you something. When you start raising up a generation of young men who think they don't need a father, they won't be a good father. I'm not saying they can't be a good father if they didn't have a father. I said if their mindset says, I don't need a father. Do you understand that? grandmama and granddaddy and meemaw and auntie, God bless all the efforts and the work that they did, but nothing is going to replace the God-ordained function of that male, M-A-L-E, man in that family that serves as that structure and that patriarch to set order and trends and culture as it pertains to how these children are going to raise them. That's going to assist in how they determine values and morals and how they treat our women and how they treat the next generation and the generation and the generation on how they're going to be birthed. And it's not good enough to raise up a generation of nice guys. Oh, they're so loving. Oh, they're so nice. No, no, no. I get that. But are they productive? How do they handle finances? Can they budget? Do they understand the significance of putting up a legacy? Are they so driven by their outer appearance that they care less about being selfish on the inside? Will they take your hard-earned legacy and jeopardize it for a night out on the town? Do you hear what I'm saying? And so we can't feed that mindset by trying to make up for what we think they lost because he wasn't there. Oh, God, help me right now. Am I helping anybody? Don't drop your heads of shame. Amen. Please don't drop your heads of shame because it's nothing to be ashamed about. It's something that we got to band together as a team and as a ministry, as a local church, and we got to fix this issue. We got to fix this issue. Why should she have to send that boy to a big brother program and he can't find a big brother right there in the local church?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Why? Amen. It's because the enemy looks for ways. Are you there, Matthew? All right, so the Lord, there you go. Okay, let's look there at verse number 14. Afterward, he appeared unto the 11 as they sat at meat, and upbraided them with their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they believed not them which had seen him after he was risen. Struggle with the people. Right? Verse 15. And he said unto them, go ye into all the world. That word war there, word there, amen, is the word cosmos in Greek. Cosmos. That word cosmos, K-O S-M-O-S, cosmos in Greek. It means world system or orderly arrangement in a universe. World system, okay? So when he says, go ye into all the world, I used to think that to go ye into all the world, and he says, and preach the gospel to every creature. I used to believe in my mind that until every single person on the face of the earth has heard the gospel of Jesus Christ, Jesus ain't coming back. But that's not what he's saying here. I had to grow in my faith. I had to mature in my faith and understand what Jesus' mission was. And his mission was this. He says, I'm sending you. Who are you? You who have been given power of attorney to go now into the world system. And what are the world systems? You can write these down. Business. Okay? The next one is government. Business first. Number two, government. I'm not going to write them down. I'll just call them out to you. Because I'm going to use this as a chart before we close. The next one is government. How many of y'all know the church is supposed to play a role in government? Listen, don't come and say you're a kingdom citizen, and in the back of your mind, you say, I don't care nothing about that stuff. This is part of our Great Commission. Okay? The next one, listen. I'm going to tell you why the church has to play a role in government. In Luke, the 10th chapter, Jesus says these words, Sister Bella. He speaks to 70 of his disciples, and he says, lo, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by enemies harm us. The 70 returned to Jesus, and they said, Jesus, even the devils are subject to us. Jesus steps back after they have exercised their power of eternity in that area. Amen? In that particular area. Jesus didn't give them power of attorney over the entire world as in the early portions of the gospel.
But at this stage, he's getting ready to release a level of authority to them that they're going to go and be sent into the world system. As they're being sent into the world system, we understand this. When he says to cast out a devil or to tread on serpents and scorpions, y'all heard the scripture that says the kingdom of heaven suffer violence and the violent must take it how?
By force.
Listen, y'all hear me when I say this. Somebody have got to empower and intercede for our soldiers who are in combat. You know, we think in the local church and what we've been trained to think, that when it comes to casting out devils, we're having an exorcist moment. Y'all listen to me now. If Jesus sent us to the world system, and he said, you're going to that world system, and out of that system, you're going to what? You're going to preach the gospel to every creature, go up. There we go. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. We don't have to march the streets of gold and wash the street and beat people up. No. That's not the assignment. The word itself is going to bring judgment upon the unbeliever. Verse 17, and these signs shall follow them that believe. Y'all see this?
Yes.
In my name, somebody say, power of attorney. They, who's the they? They that's been given the power of attorney. They shall cast out what?
Devil.
Okay? They not the devil. Do you see that? But devils with an S. And it's a little D. Which lets us know we're not particularly or only talking about Satan himself, the entity. But this is talking about devils that have occupied these world systems. And government is one of them. So when we start seeing threats coming across our nation, listen to me when I hear you hear me say this. When we start seeing the nation of North Korea marching through the streets with nuclear weapons and missiles that can reach the U.S., and we've got soldiers that are in embassies that are over there overseas that are serving in those embassies, who do you think the first strike is going to come at before they come to the homeland of the United States? They're going to hit who's right there in that embassy, because they understand if they take out the embassy, they take out the representation of the nation. And if they take out the representation of the nation, there's no intelligence to come from that place back to where? The homeland of the U.S. Now, if I'm wrong, those of you who are gifted in warfare, y'all can correct me. But the last time I checked, amen, somebody, our soldiers need somebody on the battlefield. And I'm not talking about out there bearing arms with them necessarily, but they need somebody like a Daniel that will go behind the scenes and begin to pray in a language that the devil can't understand. So that's the role that the church has to play in government. That's why every ministry must have a focus on our armed forces. Not only just those who are active duty, but those who are veterans and those who have retired. Whether they be in a home or wherever they be in, that local assembly must have a focus. You know what we do? We stick strictly along with rest home ministry. You know why? Because that makes me feel good about myself. We want to go just feed homeless for a while, because that makes me feel good about ourselves. Well, there are fraternities that do that type of work. But we need to step back into that dimension where we got people who have served their country and have lost loved ones for their country and have gone overseas and bled and died. Amen, somebody. That we might here in this United States of America stand flat-footed and preach the gospel without the threat of ISIS coming in this house and want to behead each and every person. Don't you understand that liberty and freedom and justice for all is all in one nation that's under God, indivisible? Now you hear what I'm telling you? That's the role that the church has to play in our government. Somebody said, we got to pray. We got to pray for our armed forces. In fact, in the name of Jesus, Father, we thank you right now. And we lift up our military forces, our army, our navy, our air force, our marines, our coast guard. Hallelujah, those that are in the reserves. And Lord, we don't know what the next move is going to be across this nation. We don't know who's going to be discipled, engaged, dispatched, and deployed. But God, we pray for a hedge of protection around our soldiers. Oh God, protect their families and protect their children. Lord, we pray, God, against chemical warfare. We pray, God, in the name of Jesus, against diseases. We pray, God, against mental anguish. Oh God, we pray utterance. Put people in his ear, God, who have a prophetic utterance that understand the seasons and the times. In the name of Jesus, Lord, we know our nation is right on the brink of another war. But God, we thank you right now. Hallelujah for victory. In the name of Jesus, touch our government and bring unity amongst the political parties. Hallelujah. God, we thank you that your word says that when the righteous reign, that the people rejoice. But when the unrighteous are in charge, that the people mourn. Lord, we thank you right now that as our American flag begins to wave, that it's not just America that shall be saved, but we pray for this globe in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah. Pray for your president more than you talk about him. Nobody said you had to like him. Nobody said you had to like any president. But he is the commander-in-chief. Regardless of what party he represents, he's the person that calls the shots. The Bible tells us that we ought to obey those who have rule over us. We can't be a kingdom church and we're biased politically. We can't be a kingdom church and we're just full of a house of Democrats. Or full of a house of Republicans. Who's going to stand for God?
That's right,
man. Hey, who's going to stand for Jesus? He said, my kingdom is not of this world. If it was of this world, my soldiers would fight. That means we don't have to stand in the marketplace and bash President Trump. We ought to stand in the secret place of the Most High and abide under the shadow of the Almighty. And I will say unto the Lord.
Yeah.
I'm trying to equip you in this house for next level living. Do you hear what I'm telling you? And in order for us to go to the next level in our life, we got to know how to deal with these next level devils. The world system. And when you go into the system, you're not just going to deal like we deal with the local church. We need that type of deliverances. When people come in demon possessed and they have those spirits, and we lay hands on those people and rebuke those unclean spirits and cast them out. But that don't tie that to that experience alone. Some of you, God is raising up in this hour to go into business, to go into government, to go into family, to go into religion, to go into entertainment, to go into media, and to go into education. Amen. Y'all need those again? Okay, we'll start with number one, business. Under business comes medicine. So if you don't see your area up here, don't get mad. Why do you say medicine come up under business? Because the doctors and the medical care workers are no longer controlling the medical field. It's the insurance companies.
That's right.
And the insurance companies can care less about your identity or your grandmama or your me mama or how poor or how rich you are. It's depending on what they're willing to pay out for that particular issue at that particular time. And some of the moves that our blessed our doctors make, they can't make it without permission. Except they do it pro bono. Out of pocket. That's why you have nations where there's no revenue and no finance, there's no medical here. Because the medical field has become a business. And we need reformers like our sister who will impact that medical community and begin to break through those strongholds that hinder the progress of people receiving healing and begin to put together programs where people can come and get needs met that may not be financially able to do it. We need to be partnered up with on-site blood drives, on-site dental procedures, on-site. Do you hear what I'm saying? We're equipped right now, Pastor Sheila, to be able to host these type venues and to bring the medical care to the people. Amen. We want the people just to come to us to attend church, but what are we taking into the system? We got in our minds, we can barely show up for rehearsals, let alone help somebody get help with some medicine. And if you don't have time to come to a crazy worship rehearsal or to a liturgical dance rehearsal, don't tell me you're ready for kingdom when you don't have a time to balance your life to serve this community.
Amen.
Amen. Woo! Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Do you sense the shift, church?
Yes.
Yes. Business, government. We talked about
that. Family, we talked about that. We'll get to the devils later. Religion, R, religion. Then we got entertainment. When our Christian entertainers are struggling finding acting positions, because all the roles that are being offered now require a perverted influence.
That's right.
So you want a Christian actor to play a homosexual actor or put a sex scene in everything. I'm not saying intimacy. I'm not saying that. Because that's natural. But certain things should not be broadcasted in our eyes.
Amen.
So you know that system has been overtaken by a devil if those who have Christian values can no longer earn a wage in that arena.
That's right.
Amen.
So I still got jobs available, but not just for you. What we've been doing over the past 10 years is we've been trying to hit that market, but we've been compromising our values. So you know, Tyler Perry got to say a few cuss words just to get everybody to come. You know, he got to act a little nasty. He got to say a couple things because he needs an audience that's not just Christian. We understand that. And we're not knocking our brother. Amen. Please understand that. I just want you to understand that role that has to be played. I mean, what was the last Christian movie that you went to at the movies? Amen. There might have been one here, but was supposed to be a Christian faith-based movie that did not have some questionable things in that movie that necessarily did not need to be added in there.
Amen.
To get the point of the message across, it's entertainment. Don't y'all take this wrong. But you're going to find out that the spirit of the land says that sex saves.
That's right.
You want to sell a car, put a half-naked woman in front of it.
That's true.
You want somebody to buy your record, you don't have to be able to rap a lick.
Right.
Just put a young lady on that video or on the label of that record that's scantily clad, and they're going to do what? They're going to buy that radio based on how she looks.
True.
Okay. Entertainment. Why do you think they run off Tim Tebow?
Yeah.
You didn't hear anything about his poor play until he started praying on the field.
Yep, that's right.
Nothing about his poor play. Now, he's just not cut out for the NFL. Nobody said anything about him until he did. I still ain't figured out why they have a problem with him praying, but before a boxer boxes.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody has nothing to say. It's because Tim Tebow was gaining ground
in
entertainment. He was developing a following.
Mm-hmm.
People were starting to listen to him. He started doing public speaking engagements. He started impacting the next generation. He started speaking and declaring truth. And they said, you know what, we got to get him out of here. Amen? What's the next one? Media. Now, we're going to go into this next week, but the media has become America's prophet.
It is.
The media has become America's prophet. The media can tear down any of these other kingdoms.